Welcome to Roosevelt House. I'm Jack Rosenthal, the former interim director of Roosevelt House, now free. As many of you know, this was the New York home of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt for 25 years until they came into possession of a somewhat larger house on Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington. Hunter President Jennifer Rabb, working with Jonathan Fanton and Faye Rosenfeld, have made this a center of scholarship on the Roosevelts and the American presidency, which is why we're gathered here tonight. First, let me say more about Faye. She's our chief operating officer for another 2 weeks. She's about to become the vice president for programming at the New York Public Library. Please join me in wishing her well on Fifth Avenue and applauding her applauding her 9 electric years here. And also in wishing Harold Holzer, our new permanent director, success in finding someone who can fill her shoes, ladylike but large. The president we address tonight is, of course, John F. Kennedy. Or to be more precise, conspiracy theories about his assassination. Max Holland is an investigative reporter par excellence. I first got to know him in 2001 when I was on a jury that gave him the prestigious J. Anthony Lucas Award for his ambitious book project about the assassination. Like everyone of a certain age, Max remembers where he was when President Kennedy was killed. On the dance floor in junior high school, desperately trying to lead a taller girl in this mandatory dancing class. Eventually, he decided to go into journalism, and in the early 1980s, he began writing for The Nation magazine. At first, he paid little attention to the still bubbling controversy over the assassination. But that changed in 1991 when he saw the movie JFK, Oliver Stone's film that just churns with ugly talk about conspiracy. Max knew enough about Washington to recognize that such a conspiracy involving the CIA and the FBI was simply not possible. The film set him off on a long journey. He has published numerous articles about the assassination. His book, The Kennedy Assassination Tapes, appeared in 2004. He's written extensively for the International Journal of Intelligence, whose editor-in-chief, Richard Valcourt, is here to join us. And Max continues to develop what he calls the culmination of his work, a need to know a political and cultural history of the Kennedy assassination, 1963 to 2013. That's the journey that brings him here tonight. And you'll soon see why I so admire his shrewd, even obsessive reporting. I'm pleased to give you Max Holland.
Thank you very much, Jack. Before I get started, I'd like to thank Jack Rosenthal for the initial invitation and Harold Holzer for honoring it and the staff that has made my stay here very comfortable. Our subject is the Zapruder film, And the first question is, what is there possibly left to say about the Zapruder film that hasn't already been said, and certainly more eloquently than I could say it? Iconic is a sorely overused word, but surely it applies to the Zapruder film. It's hard to overestimate how 6 feet of 8mm film has penetrated the collective consciousness and imagination. It has been the subject of books, movies, plays, doctoral theses, performance art, fine art, and parody. It's been called the most influential film of our time, bar none. It has broken conventions dictating what audiences can see, and Hollywood taboos about screen violence collapsed in the aftermath of the Zapruder film. And certainly, Abraham Zapruder was the forerunner of what we see so often today, which is average citizens capturing the news with handheld devices. Perhaps the ultimate alkylade is that Zapruder is now a verb also. To be Zaprudered, according to one scholar, means to undergo a transformation whereby images that were once descriptive, anchored in what they showed, have been loosened from their chains and set out on unending journeys that continue to perplex and fascinate. Perhaps the most poignant observation about the film that I've ever come across is no matter how many times you see it, when you see it again, you hope against hope that this time JFK is going to come through unscathed. But of course, he never does. Now, the predicate for my talk, of course, is that there is one thing that still has not been understood about the Zapruder film. It does not depict what most of us think it depicts. And before getting into the details of this, I want to make a large caveat, which is that it's not a hard story to understand, but it's extremely convoluted, and I have to leave out a lot of the twists and turns in order to get to the gist of the thing. I don't want to bore you to death with details, and I don't have that much time to get into them, so please excuse if I gloss over things that you're familiar with. We'll start with the publication of Life magazine, the first issue after the assassination. They had just bought for $150,000, which is still a lot of money today, the Zapruder film, all rights worldwide to the film. Now that's, in today's dollars, $1.2 million, so it was quite an investment. And the first issue of Life featured these frames across two pages of the split-second sequence that resulted in the tragic death, the fate which befell our president. According to Life, they weren't very specific, but essentially they said the president was waving, and he has a clutching movement toward his throat. John Connolly turns around, then he himself is struck by a bullet, and then Kennedy collapses, which was a nice way of saying that he had been shot in the head. So you had three shots, each of which hit their mark. Almost simultaneously, that same week, right after the assassination, you had an interview with John Connolly on November 27th, the day before Thanksgiving, that was broadcast on NBC nationally from his hospital bed in Parkland Hospital. And of course, the notion was, here we're going to get firsthand testimony from a most important witness to what happened. Connolly told the interviewer, "We had just turned the corner. I was sitting in the jump seat." Actually, he was crammed into the jump seat. He was 6'4", 6 feet 4 inches, and it was a very tight fit for him. He heard a shot right after they turned. He was an experienced hunter. He immediately recognized it as a rifle shot, and he immediately thought the president was a target. As he turned, he was hit. And then, although these weren't exactly his words, there was a sickening thud, like the sound of a grapefruit being hurled against a brick wall, which was the president's head being hit by the third shot. Now, a word about life's influence in those days. It's hard to overestimate. The magazine had a circulation of 7 million, but many more readers than that. It would be today's equivalent of something going viral. Every week, life showed America to itself. It was a mighty media colossus, the crown in the Time Life empire. And as one scholar, a very shrewd scholar of the Zapruder film, wrote, "It was of profound importance that Zapruder's images first found public exposure in Henry Luce's Picture magazine. Here it was implied that images nearly spoke for themselves, that knowledge, perhaps truth, was ensured by the camera's expanded vision. The defining concept for the magazine, its own enabling fiction, asserted that the photograph, not the word, was the privileged signifier." Now, the first article in Life actually set off an initial wave of suspicion about what had happened, because Oswald had not used an automatic rifle. He'd used a bolt action, actually World War I era, but it was a World War II surplus rifle from Italy, a Mannlicher Carcano. A bolt action rifle takes time to operate as opposed to an automatic rifle. You have to work the bolt to put in a cartridge. After you fire, you have to work the bolt to extract the spent cartridge and work the bolt again to put in a new round from the clip. Now, the FBI soon estimated that you could reasonably get off two shots in the space of 2.3 seconds, just physically. It took that much time to physically operate the rifle. Now, that did not comport with Life's split-second analysis. So the next week, Life came out with another article called "End to Nagging Rumors." Now it wasn't a split-second sequence, it was a six-second sequence. And whereas before they hadn't even acknowledged Zapruder or that they had bought this film, they tried to suggest that Life was ever present wherever it needed to be worldwide. Now they openly admitted there was an 8mm film that they didn't necessarily take that was a time clock of the assassination and showed and proved that Oswald had the time to commit his act. And this time, the article itself was one full page, and this time they put color prints from the Zapruder film in the magazine, and were very specific about when the shots occurred. The first shot was at Zapruder frame 190. They had sequentially numbered the frames. And this is Z190. The second shot, when Conley was hit, 4.17 seconds later, Z264. So now both the president and Conley are wounded. The third shot, now this was not actually in the magazine because part of the agreement with Zapruder was whatever use was made of the film would be very tasteful. So they actually showed a few slides after this, but this was the impact point of the third shot. Altogether, it took 6.8 seconds, but Life, I guess because it was more sibilant, reduced it to six, the six critical seconds. As a journalist, I could certainly understand Life's impulse to get a scoop based on its exclusive access to one of the most important pieces of evidence. But this article actually marked the privileging of the Zapruder film over all other evidence. It was a conceit put forward by Life and never really questioned or doubted. In other words, you didn't really need to know the totality of the evidence, ballistic, forensic, eyewitness, ear witness, to represent what happened. All you really needed to do was look at the Zapruder film. As the cliche goes, seeing was believing, or perhaps more accurately, believing or knowing consisted solely of seeing. Now, to give you an idea of the trap life set for itself, this was the view from Oswald's perch at frame Z190 when ostensibly the first shot was fired. You don't think that Oswald would fire the first shot when the president is almost completely obscured by an oak tree that was right outside the window. But life didn't know this because they didn't write the article from Dallas. They wrote it from their headquarters in New York. Now, the United States government, namely the CIA, FBI, and Federal Bureau of Investigation, had good copies of the Zapruder film, and of course, they were analyzing it too. And they weren't bound by what life said had happened, but they were influenced by it. And they too fell into the trap of equating the film with the assassination and not weighing it against all the totality of the evidence. The FBI did not put the first shot at Z190, they put it after the tree because they thought it would not be likely he'd be firing through the tree. And in the conclusion that they delivered to the Warren Commission, because the Warren Commission was actually charged with evaluating the FBI's report and seeing if it needed any amending or correcting or further development. And it was quite conceivable there would have been no separate Warren report if they'd been happy with the FBI report, but they weren't. But the FBI reported to the Warren Commission its conclusion that the best estimate of the time interval of shots is approximately 6 seconds from the first to the last, with the second shot approximately in the middle of the 6 second period. And in the model that they gave to the Warren Commission in January 64, you can see three strings from the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository to the Elm Street roadway below, and those represent the path of the bullets. Now, the Warren Commission comes along, and in January it looks at the Zapruder film. In February it looks at the Zapruder film. In March it looks at the Zapruder film. And in April it realizes there's something terribly wrong. Norman Redlich, who was a staff counsel, put it in a memo to J. Lee Rankin, the general counsel, this way: the facts which we now have in our possession, submitted to us in separate reports from the FBI and Secret Service, are totally incorrect, and if left uncovered, will present a completely misleading picture. And what he was referring to was the fact that 2.3 seconds was roughly equivalent to 42 frames of the Zapruder film. And if you looked at the film, there weren't 42 frames in between when the president was in obvious distress and when Governor Connally was in obvious distress. So that meant only either one of two things. There were two shooters who shot separately, and one of them is still at large, and the trail's getting pretty cold by the day, or else just possibly one bullet went through both men. Of course, if there were two shooters, that's practically the definition of a conspiracy. So the Warren Commission, in May 1964, did a restaging of the assassination. This is something they didn't anticipate ever doing. And by May 64, they were already supposed to be delivering the report. And this was probably the tensest period of the commission's existence, because if they could not corroborate the possibility that one bullet had gone through both the president and Governor Connally, that meant there was a conspiracy. And they did corroborate it. When you lined up the president and Governor Connally, you realized that one bullet hit President Kennedy in the back at 1,900 feet per second. It exited his throat at 1,700 feet per second. And of course, it had to hit Governor Connally. this would be derided as a magic bullet, but a real magic bullet is a bullet that would have disappeared, which is the only other possible explanation. So the Warren Commission made a huge contribution to our forensic understanding of what happened, correcting a misunderstanding that the FBI had considered the truth. And really, it is only the only addition that the Warren Commission made to the basic facts of what happened. But if one bullet went through two of them, then what happened to the bullet that missed? You know, when the rubber hit the road and they really had to write the Warren report, the fact is they didn't know. They had spent so much time and effort corroborating the fact that one bullet had struck two that they had really no time left to figure out what happened to that missing bullet. In fact, they didn't even know whether it was the first shot fired that missed, the second shot fired that missed, or the third shot. So in about 5 pages of the Warren report, using ironclad reasoning, they went through all the permutations. The first shot missed, or the second shot missed, or the third shot missed. Now, it made the most sense that the third shot missed, because the president would be farthest away then. But virtually everyone who testified said that the shot to the head was the third shot and the final shot. So there was really no grounds for believing that. Alternately, the first shot was entertained as missing. The problem with that is, how are you going to explain someone who hit the president in the upper back at 190 feet and in the head at 265 feet, and yet he missed him entirely at a distance of 100 or 120 feet? There was no good. That didn't seem to make sense either. So without being terribly specific about it, the Warren Commission's conclusions was that one shot hit the president and the governor, one hit the president only, and one missed, and we don't know which of the three was that. A wide range of possibilities precludes a conclusive finding. So the early premise of the Zapruder film, that it was a time clock that was going to show us exactly what happened, was not fulfilled. And the Warren Commission presented like a cafeteria. Dealey Plaza was like a cafeteria. You could choose which shooting sequence you wanted to believe. It was almost as if every time you looked at the Zapruder film, it happened a different way. Of course, it happened only one way, but the Warren Commission was not able to determine what that one way was. And what they didn't anticipate was that not only would people be dissatisfied with this on the one hand, on the other hand, and there's a third hand, people would also think that none of the above was good either. And so within 2 years of its publication, the Warren Report comes into disrepute. The soft underbelly of the report is how the president was killed, exactly the shooting sequence. And it was a bitter pill in November 1966 when Life, which had done so much to, let's say, muck up the issue to begin with, came out with a cover story that claimed it was a matter of reasonable doubt whether Oswald had killed the president. And this wasn't the only publication. You had books by Mark Lane, Ed Epstein, the Saturday Evening Post had a cover story. The Warren Commission fell into disrepute in 1966 and really has never, ever recovered. Now, because of this questioning of the report, not all of it from well-intentioned people, I might add, CBS, which was the Tiffany of the news networks, decided to undertake a reinvestigation beginning in the fall of 1966. It was aired in June of 1967, if you can believe it, for 1 hour on 4 successive nights. So it was a huge devotion of CBS's resources, Walter Cronkite, Dan Rather, the whole bunch of them. And a big part of the CBS report was devoted to how. And CBS did something the Warren Commission did not do. It replicated the exact shooting parameters, the elevation, the distance, and the speed. The Warren Commission had relied on the FBI using tests that fired at stationary targets. And even though the car wasn't moving that quickly, there's a big difference between firing at a stationary target and an object moving 11 miles an hour. Now, CBS found that the commission's account required Oswald to outperform marksmen at their own trade. It could be done. One or two guys did pull it off. But it was the rare marksman who could fire three shots in less than 6 seconds, and most of them took far longer, up to 8.25 seconds. Now, the second scenario that the Warren Commission had developed was that the first shot hit both men, the second shot missed, and the third shot hit the president in the head. And this all had to take place in 4.8 to 5.6 seconds. That was the time allotted. So here CBS was saying it was almost impossible to pull that off. In 17 out of 37 attempts, 46% of the time, marksmen were unable to get off three shots and sometimes even two in the time allotted. CBS therefore concluded counterintuitively that it was the first shot that missed. Other possibilities were ruled out as implausible or contradicting the evidence. Now, the next time the CBS revisited the issue was in 1975, and this time they had access to the Zapruder film. And they hired a company in Cambridge, Massachusetts called ITEC, which did work for the United States government, the CIA, the National Reconnaissance Office, and they did digital analysis, which today, of course, is much more commonplace, but in those days, it was path-breaking. And ITEC analyzed the Zapruder film and came to four conclusions. Again, it could not determine when the first shot was fired. The second shot struck Kennedy no later than Zapruder frame 223. The single bullet theory or conclusion was confirmed. Connally was in obvious distress by 225. Two frames later, and the head motion of the bullet that struck the president was consistent with the rear entrance of a high-velocity projectile. Now we're going to fast forward about 25 to 30 years to what I considered the rational consensus that had developed by the 1990s, early 2000s, and I freely admit I was part of it. These are authors like Gerald Posner, Dale Myers, who worked with Peter Jennings on a very good 40th anniversary program that used computer-generated graphics to show us what happened. Larry Sturtevant, who is a wounds ballistic expert, advisor to the House Select Committee on Assassinations, and Vincent Bugliosi. They all had the shooting between 8 and 9 seconds. They all had the first shot, except for Bugliosi, who had a little earlier, at around 160, 150. The third shot, of course, was 313, and the second shot was 222, 223. What they were all saying, basically, was that just as the car was about to go under the tree, Oswald fired his rifle. And either it missed because it hit a branch of the tree or because of a phenomenon among shooters known as buck fever. This is when a hunter sees a deer, gets so excited that although it's a completely easy shot, he misses. And it's not unknown phenomena. So that's how what they attributed Oswald's miss to, buck fever, basically. And that the shots, the second and third shot, took place after the car cleared the oak tree. What was clear in the consensus analysis was that everything was still viewed within the confines of the Zapruder film. It was still privileged at the expense of other evidence. As the New York Times critic Richard Woodward wrote, the assassination had become fused with one representation, so much so that Kennedy's death was virtually unimaginable without the Zapruder film. Now, the problems with the consensus, the things that they tended to dismiss or ignore, were these. It really didn't seem an adequate answer to why Oswald missed so badly. Because you have to remember, he missed the president, yes, but he missed everybody in the car as well. He missed the car. Now, this was a car that was 20 feet long, 6 feet wide, at a distance of about 100 and 110 feet. I mean, that's literally the broadside of a barn. How could he miss? Even if it hit a tree branch, it's not going to be deflected that much. And even if he has a case of buck fever, it doesn't quite hold up. There were also several ballistic phenomena that weren't really resolved. I'll get into these a little more later. There was a concrete skirt on Elm Street, which people had seen a burst of debris at the time of the first shot. And then way down in Dealey Plaza, right at the underpass, there was a third victim, a man named James Tague, who had a scratch on his cheek that was associated with the first shot. But the element that wasn't at all addressed by the consensus view was that it also contradicted ear witness testimony. 62% of the people who were in Dealey Plaza and heard three shots said there was more time between the first and second shot than between the second and third. And all the consensus views, you had less time, the exact opposite. Now, in 2007, I interviewed Wynn Lawson, who's the man in the circle there. Wynn Lawson was a Secret Service agent who advanced the trip to Dallas. And to show you what kind of man he was, after the assassination, when he was back in Washington, agents came up to him and said, "If it had to happen, I'm glad it happened on your watch." And when I heard that, I thought it was the cruelest thing I'd ever heard. But it was actually, they were paying him a high compliment, because they knew if Wynn Lawson had advanced the trip, that he had followed every single procedure that the Secret Service was supposed to follow. And if the problem, and of course there was a problem, it was not in the procedures that were followed, but in the procedures themselves. That the whole idea of having a president ride in an open limousine could not happen ever again. And I was calling Wynn Lawson because I wanted to talk to him about a meeting on Monday that had taken place in Dallas between the Kennedy and the Connally forces. A month before President Kennedy had come to Dallas, the U.S. ambassador to the U.N. had visited Dallas. His name was Adlai Stevenson. And he was spat upon, jostled, pushed, and he thought his life was in danger when he gave a talk in Dallas because of the right-wing fervor there. Dallas was the capital of that kind of attitude in the 1960s. And so the Connally forces did not want President Kennedy to ride in a motorcade in Dallas. They were afraid someone was going to throw a tomato at him or an egg and there'd be a very unsightly incident. The Kennedy people wanted a motorcade. If there wasn't a motorcade in Dallas, it would be the only one of the five Texas cities President Kennedy was going to visit that wouldn't have a motorcade. And it would raise questions, was the president afraid? There was also a problem with the trademark luncheon. Everybody who was invited, this was the cream of Dallas society. I don't know if 2% of them had voted for President Kennedy, and they certainly weren't going to be voting for him in 1964. The Democrats had been shut out of the one event in Dallas. So they wanted a motorcade because that was the only way the president was going to be seen by the Dallas citizenry. And finally, the city fathers also wanted a motorcade because Dallas had come under extreme criticism because of the Stevenson incident. Just coincidentally, In that month, October 63, or the month before, CBS News had moved from 15 minutes a day to 30 minutes. And so they needed footage. And one of the pieces of footage that they broadcast was showing Adlai Stevenson being spat upon. And so it had become a national scandal. So Dallas also wanted a motorcade. And to make sure that it happened, the Democrats who were in that meeting leaked the news of it to a Dallas Times-Herald reporter named Jim Lehrer, who was the first to publish the news on Tuesday that there would be a motorcade in downtown Dallas. Now, that's why I was calling Win Lawson, because he was at that meeting. And without me prompting him, he said, "I don't care what anybody says, there was more time between the first and second shot than between the second and third." He had been in the lead car that was almost at the underpass at the time of the assassination. And I hadn't asked him about that. He just offered it up. And I said, "You know, that's very interesting. I've read that many times. But what about this meeting on Monday?" You know, it really wasn't what I wanted to talk to him about. But after I hung up the phone, I remember it bothered me that he had said that. Because when you do a lot of interviewing, you develop, you know, a sense about the authority of what people have to offer. And he was a very quiet and dignified man, and obviously this was his most painful subject in the world, and he handled it with great dignity. And I was very impressed during my interview with him. And it just bothered me that somehow it was different than having read it 15 times, that he said this to me. So, for the first time, I became a Zapruder frameologist. I had never gotten into, you know, what happened at frame 222. That really was never my interest. My interest had always been in the investigations and the politics of the investigations of the assassination. And I actually contacted Larry Sturtevant, one of the leading consensus writers, and whose work I much respected, and I said, "You know, Larry, I've read this many times, but I just had this interview with Win Lawson, and he just blurted it out. And, you know, it's the opposite of what your scenario says. What do you think about this?" And he said, "Well, you know, this is a very traumatic event. Human beings are not tape recorders," and he's just wrong. And, of course, there is a lot of wrong testimony about what happened in Dealey Plaza. It still bothered me. So I went back to this, doing some arithmetic. Now, you might have missed this when we saw the Zapruder film, but the film actually has two segments. The first 7 seconds are just these motorcycle policemen driving by. And Zapruder, in those days, of course, film was precious. He didn't exactly know how much he had left in his camera, so he stopped his camera. And he waited until he could be absolutely sure that the president was within view. So from frame 1 to 132, you know, you can call it the Zapruder film, but it's really not interesting. The only frames that matter are frames 133 to 486, 19 seconds. Now, just for argument's sake, we know that the third shot was at 333. That's 313. That's beyond dispute. It's so obvious. And we take 223 as the accepted point for the second shot. We'll put the first shot at the earliest possible frame of the Zapruder film, 133. What you're going to get is three almost exactly equally spaced shots, which again does not comport with what Win Lawson said. Effectively, what he said meant that the first shot had to happen before 133. And when I realized this, I practically had a sense of vertigo. I mean, how could something not be on the Zapruder film? It's practically un-American. As one scholar of the film wrote, The Zapruder film is the holy relic of presidential martyrdom, a document of the last moments of American idealism and innocence, a testament to government ineptness at best, nefarious conspiracy at worst. So then I wondered, what exactly is the basis for thinking all three shots have to be on the Zapruder film? I mean, where did that come from? And it came from Abraham Zapruder on that terrible night of November 22nd, 1963. The president had been killed in midday. It was like a nightmare. We didn't know it wasn't just a nightmare, that it was true, until Air Force One landed at Andrews Air Force Base, and instead of President Kennedy walking off the plane, they unloaded a casket. And there was that dark night, desolate night for all Americans. And Richard Stolle, who was the West Coast editor of Life, headquartered in Los Angeles, had raced to Dallas. And one of the first things he learned from the Life stringer there was that a man named Zapruder, and on this hinges a lot of history, because if his name had been Smith, Stolle would never have found him that night. He called him up at 11:30 on Friday, November 22nd, and he asked him four questions. "I've heard you film the assassination. Is that true?" "Yes." "Do you have the film now?" "Yes." "Can I see it?" "No." "Did you film the assassination from beginning to end?" "Yes." Now, of course, Zapruder was telling the truth as he knew it. When he restarted his camera, the president was alive and smiling, and by the time that segment ended, the president was dead. But we know something very important about Zapruder's sense of the completeness of what he saw. There was a Dallas Times Herald reporter named Darwin Payne, whose office was not 10 minutes from Dealey Plaza. As soon as he heard the police bulletin of shots fired, he raced over there. The second person he talked to happened to work for Abe Zapruder and told him about this possibility of the film. The third person Darwin Payne interviewed was Abraham Zapruder, and these are his notes from that interview, not 20 minutes after the assassination. "I got film. The president slumped over with the first shot. At the first shot, he bent over and grabbed his throat. The second of two shots hit him in the head. He couldn't be alive. She was beside him after the last shot. She crawled over the back of the car." And what is apparent from this is Zapruder's first shot is actually the second shot, and his second shot was the third shot. He simply didn't hear the first shot. Now, he wasn't alone in this, and there's no shame in it. Most people in Dealey Plaza reported hearing three shots. They found three cartridges on the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository. But about 12% of the people there, mostly people who were completely unfamiliar with firearms, didn't recognize the first pop as the sound of a rifle shot. And Zapruder was one of these. So I realized that there was a possibility of a colossal misunderstanding, that the shooting sequence had been conflated with the film, when it was possible they were two different things. Now, the first thing I thought of was that not on the Zapruder film, it was a phrase I'd heard somewhere before. And I thought where I'd heard it, and I heard it in the testimony of Lyndall Schoenfeld. Schoenfeld was the FBI agent who helped the Warren Commission do the reconstruction of May 1964. And at the time, and to their utter surprise, the president's silhouette of his upper torso came into Oswald's line of sight at a point before the Zapruder film. And they labeled this position A, noted it. And this is what it really means. This is a still from a Secret Service restaging that took place on November 27th, 1963. It was not done for investigative criminal purposes. It was done to show the agents back in Washington and elsewhere what had happened so it wouldn't happen again. And they filmed the car, this in this case a white Lincoln Continental, which wasn't as long as the presidential limousine, going through Dealey Plaza with still and a moving picture camera. Now, as it happens, this car in this picture is roughly at position A. The upper body of President Kennedy is in Oswald's line of sight. And Marines are taught, and Oswald was an ex-Marine, to aim at the upper body mass. We've all seen pictures of those silhouettes. You don't aim at the head, you don't aim at an arm, you aim at the upper body mass. The ghost car, which I had inserted in this photo, is the car when Zapruder restarted his camera. So you realize that whole turn into Dealey Plaza, Zapruder didn't film. And he was restarting his camera after the car was already 72 feet into Dealey Plaza. I was able to interest National Geographic TV in this issue, and that gave me the wherewithal really to do the research that was necessary. Because it wasn't enough to point out the shortcomings of the consensus view. You had to have positive evidence that this alternative explanation were true. So the first thing I thought is, if it is true, there have to be eyewitnesses who saw it this way. Not everybody, but there are going to have to be some. And very easily I found one. His name was Amos Ewens. He was a 15-year-old kid from across the river. I think, in fact, he attended Franklin D. Roosevelt High School in Dallas. His mother dropped him off in Dealey Plaza. And he was one of the very few witnesses brought up to Washington from Dallas. And the reason why was because when everybody raced up the grassy knoll, he told police, "You're going to the wrong place. There was a rifle in that window." And this was his statement to the sheriff's department that afternoon. "About the time the car got near the black and white sign, I heard a shot." Now, this is very significant because he was one of the very few people who put the shot in, you know, space where the president was when he heard the first shot. And we were able to interview him. That's him in the picture on the left. And in the picture on the right, I've again used a Secret Service still and outlined the black and white signs he was talking about. These are those old U.S. highway badge signs like Route 66. This sign isn't in Dealey Plaza anymore. It's been replaced by interstate signs. But he was standing on this, you know, roughly where he is in this picture, and those were the black and white signs that he was referring to in his initial police report. And of course, I found other eyewitnesses, none as good as him perhaps, but I did find others. Then there was the issue of the ejected cartridges. This is how the cartridges were found on the sixth floor of the school book depository. Two under the windowsill, one several feet away. Now, it's standard procedure that cartridge ejection patterns can be used to analyze the specifics of a shooting. National Geographic hired a Marine reservist who was roughly the same height as Oswald, and Marine training really hasn't changed all that much. And we had him try to replicate the shell casing pattern. Now, the first shot, which was roughly equivalent to position A, the rifle was was practically perpendicular to the building, and the shell casing came right toward us. For the next two shots, in which he had to shift in order to shoot further down Elm Street, both cartridges hit the books that Oswald had piled up to hide himself, and they fell against the windowsill. Exactly the pattern the shells were discovered on November 22nd. We must have done this 20 times, and 17 or 18 times they fell in exactly that pattern. So, by this time, we had eyewitness corroboration of a pre-Zapruder first shot, some eyewitness corroboration. The pattern of spent cartridges worked. And it also turned out that the Zapruder film itself impeaches the idea of the Zapruder film capturing all three shots. And the place to look is not in the presidential limousine, which always was the focus of attention, but in the follow-up car full of Secret Service, brimming with Secret Service agents. There was an eyewitness named Malcolm Summers, who's this fellow here falling to the ground after the third shot. And in an oral history, he said they came around, the first shot was fired, he thought it was a firecracker, and the Secret Service people looked down at the ground as if it were a firecracker. And then the car kept coming, and there were the second and third shots. We don't have time to play it, but if you look at this man in the circle, that Secret Service agent, George Hickey, at about frame 144, 145, he leans way over the car. And if you read his testimony, he talks about how he thought a firecracker had been thrown at the car, and he was looking for it. Now, if he's moving at frame 144, that means something happened before that. You know, because this is a mediated reaction. It's not a startle reaction. The rifle wasn't fired against his ear. He had to first recognize it as a sound that didn't belong. Then his brain had to decide what to do in reaction. His brain had to tell his muscles to move, and then his muscles had to move. All that takes, you know, a second and a half or a second. But in Zapruder film terms, that pushes it before 133. Once we're no longer spellbound by the idea that the Zapruder film had to capture all three shots, it also explains why Oswald missed so badly and some of the unexplained ballistic phenomena associated exclusively with the first shot. Now, this was the concrete skirt that I referred to. It was actually this grass had been disturbed. And there's several pictures right after the assassination, law enforcement officers picking at this grass, looking for, you know, evidence of a bullet. They found nothing because the bullet had just gone through a couple inches of the turf. This was the mark on the curb way down in Dealey Plaza near the underpass. The man with the arrow pointing to him is James Tague. He was the fellow who had been cut on the cheek. And this is Tague's view back towards the school book depository. That bag that circled there is the curb where the bullet struck, and the other circle is where Tague was roughly standing. And that's Tague with his little cut. It's, you know, practically nicked with a shave. This is in Dealey Plaza right after the assassination. Now, when the Secret Service did its restaging November 27th, they ran the car through Dealey Plaza, first in slow motion, then at the speed of the limousine, and then they did something which was inadvertently brilliant. They put the camera in the car and pointed it at the window instead of the other way around. And you realize, and that's the picture on the left, you realize there were two obstacles in Dealey Plaza. One, of course, is the fabled oak tree, but then there was this 2-inch steel pipe that was part of the traffic assembly at the corner, quite capable possibly of deflecting a bullet. And with Nat Geo's assistance, I went up there on a lift to do the first inspection ever of this arm mast. And joining me were Frank Durange, who was a former unit chief of the ballistics division of the FBI lab, and John Joe Howlett, who was the agent who had shot that Secret Service film. And by his own description, probably looked out of the sixth-floor museum more than any other human being for the 6 months after the assassination. Now, that inspection that we did was, you know, really for film purposes. It wasn't, you know, it was kind of show and tell. It wasn't a forensic inspection. You couldn't shut off traffic for days. Dealey Plaza still used. There was a lot of signage attached to the mast arm. The tree had grown much bigger and was in the way. So after the program was broadcast in November 2012, Frank and I, knowing that It really hadn't been inspected, starting writing letters to the FBI, asking them to take down this traffic assembly. Now, these cost $12,000 to $15,000, so it's not an easy request. We offered to buy it at one point from the city of Dallas, but they wouldn't entertain that idea. Our greatest fear was that because there's so much traffic at that intersection, people constantly walking irrespective of the lights, that someday a vehicle was going to ram into that traffic assembly. They're going to have to take it down, throw it in the junkyard, and we'd never get a chance to inspect it. And that's exactly almost what happened in July of 2012. I got a call from Dallas. We had pestered them so much by that time that they knew of our interest. And a car had hit the traffic assembly, knocked it down. We made a beeline for Dallas. It was 103 degrees then in the shade that day. We spent all day in the sun. To make it very succinctly, there were three layers of paint on the arm mast that had been painted very haphazardly. And we realized that this was going to take still even more time to examine. So eventually, the Department of Parks and Recreation, which had ownership of the mast, put it in a shed, built a fixture for us. And this is Frank during one of our inspections. Now, one of the most important things we were able to accomplish with the Nat Geo show is that we were able to measure the angles from the window. The coupler is what we're using for the mast, and the angles of deflection necessary to get from the mast arm to the concrete skirt to the curb adjacent to James Tague. We were never able to find an indentation that we thought was eureka, this is it. So eventually, we decided to look at the problem from the other perspective. We're looking for a needle in the haystack. What does the needle look like? So with the cooperation of H.P. White, which was the same ballistics company that had assisted CBS in 1967, we were able to take a Mannlicher Carcano and fire it at exemplars of the mast. Now, this was harder to do than it looked, because a 16th of an inch difference makes a huge difference in terms of the impact on the mast arm. Sometimes we had one shot, it's not shown here, where the bullet went straight through one side of the arm. It had that much power. But with test number three, we were able to get the slight deflection we were looking for. And it turned out to be the thickness of a piece of paper. Certainly nothing you're going to find 50 years later because of the corrosive atmosphere in any city of Dallas's size. This was the area of the mast arm that we decided was the most likely area of impact, ultimately. And this is the final explanation that we developed. Oswald fired as soon as position A was achieved. He wasn't Hamlet-like. You know, what am I up here to do? Should I kill the president or shouldn't I? He had waited the whole time the car was coming toward him, and as soon as it turned away from him, and as soon as he had the optimal silhouette, that's when he fired the shot. Now, whether the rifle might not have been sighted with the sight correctly at that distance, or perhaps he just didn't get the shot off before the mast arm got in the way. It didn't hit anybody in the car, and it didn't hit the car. Instead, it went way down into Dealey Plaza, caused that burst of debris at the skirt, then hit the curb near where Tague was standing. The reason there was a pause that when Lawson heard is because Oswald could not work the bolt fast enough to fire again before the car came under the went under the tree. He had to wait. He had to wait till it cleared the tree, and then he could fire the second and third shots. And if you put this all together, the assassination didn't take 4.6 seconds, and it didn't take 6, it didn't take 6.8, it took 11 seconds. Now, why is this all important and significant? On the one hand, it only underscores that Oswald did it. I mean, it doesn't contradict the Warren Report. It clarifies it. I think it's an important clarification. And I was very proud when I talked to Norman Redlich, who became the dean of NYU Law School for many years and was a brilliant man, wrote for The Nation, incidentally. You know, I had never been able to get Norman to admit that, you know, the Warren Report was so much as missing a dotted I or a cross T. But after spending an hour and a half with him on the phone, he did agree that if they had understood the possibility of a shot before the Zapruder film, he would have written the report, obviously, differently. Other members of the Warren Commission staff didn't have the same reaction. Some of them thought it was a trifle. One of them said, it's a harmless error. You know, the legal doctrine that you're not guaranteed a perfect trial, you're guaranteed a fair trial. And if there are errors made during the course of your trial, but really the conviction should stand, you know, tough luck. Well, I don't think it was a harmless error, because if you look at the historiography of the criticism of the Warren Report, the Warren Commission had to answer three questions. Who, why, and how? Because what and when were obvious. Why was entirely contingent on who. Who was mostly contingent on how. I say mostly because even if one man did it, that left open the possibility that he had Confederates, you know, who didn't accompany him to Dealey Plaza. So it was mostly contingent on how. But how was the one area where the Warren Commission could have and should have reached a clear and compelling conclusion, because why and who were always going to have some elements of unknowingness. Two people can look at Oswald's background and come to two different conclusions about, you know, why he did it. He just hated everybody. He couldn't afford to buy his wife a washing machine, so he struck down the president. I happen to believe he was a politicized sociopath. But how was the soft underbelly of the Warren Commission? And if you look at the attacks, as exemplified by the Life magazine cover story of 1966, that's what put the commission in disrepute. Because once they didn't offer, and in fact offered some false explanations of how, it meant that it opened a Pandora's box of, you know, the wildest speculation. I'd like to end with a quote from Susan Sontag. Her book on photography was kind of an inspiration because it has so many aphorisms, and this is one: images usurp reality. And it's only when we free ourselves from the self-imposed blinders about what the Zapruder film represents that we can see the film as it truly is and what it actually captured. It is a time clock of the assassination, but it's a time clock of an assassination that had already commenced. I'll end there and be glad to answer your questions.
I knew what you were going to say before, but I'm still stunned. And I wonder, what now? How does this get published as a PS or a addendum to the Warren Report?
Well, I think it's really, you know, my book has gone so many shifts since I started it, and one of them now is I'm much more critical of the Warren Commission than I was when I started out, and it's primarily because of this issue. There was very poor coordination within the staff. You know, the investigation was sort of broken down in these sections, which you had to do. But there wasn't enough communication amongst the people working in very highly related areas, such as the ballistics and or the, you know, what Oswald did in Dealey Plaza. So I think the Warren Committee, I mean, it's, you know, you can never prove a counterfactual, but
And I believe the commission would have come under, you know, great scrutiny otherwise, anyway, in any case, and been attacked, because a lot of the attacks were political in nature. Mark Lane, Jim Garrison. But if they had answered the question of how, I think the truth, you know, is very stubborn. It repels false answers and attracts further corroboration. And we wouldn't have this level of nonsense where this really esteemed group of Americans, or they were esteemed in, when they were appointed, you know, if you look at Cheers, the final episode, I think it was ridiculed, the Warren Commission. Commission was ridiculed in a Seinfeld episode. It's, you know, it's become the butt of a lot of jokes.
This all happened on the fifth floor of sixth the School Book Depository. There is now on the sixth floor a museum. And if I remember correctly, it has been pretty much a home for conspiracy theories. But then, am I right, they invited you to come and make this presentation there. And how did they react to that?
Well, actually, the Oswald was on the sixth floor, and it's the sixth and seventh floors that are now a museum. And, you know, just how that came about is a fascinating story, because people in Dallas wanted basically to tear down the building. And they had I.M. Pei construct a memorial to President Kennedy four blocks away. And Jim Lehrer actually wrote the inscription on the wall. And it looks like a bunch of Legos, really. And that's what they tried to draw people to when they came to Dallas. But of course, everybody wanted to go to Dealey Plaza. And it was only in the late 80s that the city kind of caved and conceded and built this museum. And of course, how were they going to handle the controversy over the assassination? You know, that was an extremely difficult position that they were in. And they've tried to be even-handed, but, you know, when you're being even-handed between the likes of the Warren Commission and Mark Lane, or Garrison, or Oliver Stone, or Jesse Ventura, who's also a big conspiracy theorist, I mean, you're elevating these people to a position they don't deserve. I was only invited because I think they've lately come to understand that they have to, you know, reach out to a broader segment of thinking about the assassination.
Let's turn to the audience. We welcome questions. Wait for the microphone to come to you. And then if you'd stand and speak clearly and tell your name and your affiliation. Sir?
My name is Jerry Lewis, and I live in the neighborhood. First of all, is it not a fact that the Senate actually came to the conclusion that the Kennedy assassination was a conspiracy? And second, are we to believe that Mark Lane and the others who have opposing viewpoints have written complete fiction, when the Mark Lane book, Plausible Denial, actually describes a trial in which Howard Hunt was convicted of being the paymaster for the CIA in the Kennedy assassination?
Well, I think, first of all, you're referring to the House Select Committee, which undertook an investigation in the mid-70s and declared that President Kennedy was killed probably as a result of a conspiracy. And no, it was probable, because they didn't have the goods. And in fact, they referred their findings to the FBI and Justice Department for further investigation, and both those bodies dismissed the findings of the House Committee. And in actuality, 90% of what the House developed supported the Warren Commission. It's a very complicated story, but basically they argued there was a fourth shot from the grassy knoll based on an acoustic tape. The acoustic tape wasn't generated in Dealey Plaza. So the whole thing was bogus. And it was really, it underscored why Lyndon Johnson appointed the Warren Commission in the first place. I mean, this was a creature of Congress. He knew how these committees operated, and the House committee was led around by the nose by a committee counsel who had a bee in his bonnet about the mafia, that the mafia had killed President Kennedy. And that's what he was going to prove come hell or high water. And that's where that whole nonsense about the acoustics came from. As far as Mark Lane goes, I mean, nothing he has ever said about the assassination is reliable. And certainly E. Howard Hunt was not the paymaster of Lee Harvey Oswald.
Bill Schultz, have there been any, noted conspiracy theorists that you've convinced otherwise? Or at least given them a little bit of doubt, and how awesome did that feel? And secondly, what's your favorite or least favorite depiction of the Zapruder film in popular culture? You mentioned Seinfeld and Cheers and whatnot.
Well, I think in my naivete in the early days, I used to think or imagine producing a definitive book that even conspiracy theorists would find persuasive. But I don't know when I gave that idea up. It was a long time ago because I think it was Mark Twain who once said, you can't argue a person logically out of a position they've arrived at illogically. You know, this it's a religion, it's a belief system, and nothing you can say. I mean, if you tamp down this conspiracy, then, you know, they've got another argument. And Vincent Bugliosi, in 900 pages, if you've ever read or seen heard of that book, you know, tried to address every conspiracy theory, some of which, you know, are, Oswald was killed after all. That's the beginning of the belief that there was something we didn't know about. And unfortunately, that's, you know, ineradicable. We have to live with that. But to go around and try and address every, all of which are mutually contradictory. I mean, they don't agree with one another. Some people believe Oswald did it, and he was part of a larger conspiracy. Others, Oliver Stone, believe he was a completely innocent bystander in Dealey Plaza. Some believe the Secret Serviceman accidentally killed the president. It's hopeless. So I've never, to my knowledge, persuaded any conspiracy theorists, and I'm not really trying to talk to them. I'm trying to talk to people who were like I was before I got into this. You know, there's things that are troubling about how the Warren Commission went about its work, things that the FBI didn't tell it, or the CIA, or Robert Kennedy. And those are the things that, you know, I think are worth addressing and thinking about. As far as my favorite depiction of the Zapruder film, I think the Seinfeld episode, you know, is just about it.
How about on this side?
Phil Fox, I'm from the neighborhood. I'm not a scholar of this, but I don't think I have ever heard any mention of any deposition from Jacqueline Kennedy. Was she involved in how, you would think her comments would be germane to this. Are you aware of any information to the sort?
She was interviewed by the Warren Commission, and she did describe what she saw. They felt they had to do it, but it wasn't scripted, but it wasn't very illuminating. More interestingly, Robert Kennedy was also asked if he had any information that he thought germane to the investigation, and he chose not to talk to the commission at all. And the reason I bring that up is because one of the telling criticisms that have been made about the Warren Commission is that the CIA withheld from the commission the fact that we were trying to kill Castro during those years. Now, there was one commissioner who actually knew that, and his name was Alan Dulles, because it had started under Dulles. But Dulles was the kind of man, he might have told John McCloy, who was a fellow Wall Street lawyer on the commission, But I doubt he would have shared that with Earl Warren, even. And but if you're going to criticize the CIA for what it did or didn't do vis-a-vis the commission, then you have to be even-handed, because Robert Kennedy knew everything the CIA was doing, because he was the one ordering them to do it.
So, I have a question from a woman. Please, on the far aisle.
Thank you. Joan Baines. The bullet is the most, the three bullets are the most important part I see. And according to what you said, I'm not quite sure. The first was supposedly hitting the traffic light and ricocheted. And that's been proven forensically that that's what would happen for it to be found in the plaza. Is that correct?
Well, we
have they done forensics?
I mean, they never found that bullet. I mean,
they never
first
found
of all,
that
oh no, I mean, they didn't know where to look for it. I mean, they even interviewed James Tague in August, the month before the report came out. They raced to interview James Tague because the U.S. attorney in Dallas said, you know, there's a man here who claims to have been injured, and you know, what are you going to say about that, and what does it mean? How does it fit in the picture? And they, you know, sort of an emergency basis went to interview him. But they never found that bullet. They didn't even understand at that time, you know, in the days and weeks, probably days afterwards when they might have found it, they didn't understand there was a missing bullet. So really, so how could they look for it?
So the second bullet went through Kennedy's throat.
Right. And,
hit Connally. And where did that end?
In his thigh.
Went through his head? Or went
no,
through his neck?
No, it went through his upper back. He was turned to the right. It exited, I think, below his nipple, passed through his wrist, and lodged
That's what I thought. It hit four body parts, correct?
I'm sorry?
It hit four body parts. It hit Kennedy, his torso, his wrist, and then his knee or thigh.
Right.
And we have that bullet.
That is the so-called magic bullet.
I saw a video that shot, you've probably seen it, where they took the same rifle, the same bullet, shot it into a cotton box, a box of cotton, and it was abîmé. It was all bent as a bullet would be. And the bullet that they supposedly have from that we're discussing is in perfect condition. And I just wondered what you have to say about that.
Well, it's not in perfect condition. It's severely flattened on one side. And you have to understand that the bullets Oswald used were jacketed. That's what the military uses, because in the Hague Convention of 1899, I think, it was agreed to by the signatories they would use jacketed bullets for wars because they made for cleaner wounds. They tended to pass through people. An unjacketed bullet with lead would tend to flatten and make, you know, blow out a huge portion of anybody. And that, so Oswald used military ammunition. It's made to pass through people. Now, it's very hard to exactly replicate. I mean, there are not too many volunteers out there who, you know, they tried with goats and, you know, different bones and but I don't think it's, you know, I mean, once you think of it, where did the bullet go if it didn't hit Connally? That, to me, is a far bigger problem than the fact that the bullet doesn't look like maybe we think it should look like.
We want to have time for a reception in the Four Freedoms Room upstairs. Max will be available for questions there for sure. But come share a glass of wine and some cookies with us. Warmest thanks.